The first speaker is Tom Hickey, who's going to speak for 10 minutes. Tom is a member of the UCU union and also is a member of the British Committee for the Universities of Palestine.
I haven't said anything yet. You might want to boo. Apologies for using the lectern, but I've lost my proper glasses, so I need this, otherwise I can't read my notes. The long history of anti-imperialist struggle has been plagued by a problem of strategy. If the objective of an anti-imperialist struggle is national liberation, then does that dictate a cross-class alliance to unify the nation against the oppressor? And if so, how does that strategy relate to the class divisions within the oppressed nation itself? Between exploited peasants and workers on the one hand, and landowners and indigenous capital on the other. And between the section of the bourgeois class that is complicit with imperialism on the one hand, and those hostile to it on the other. Now, the resolution of that strategic question then dictates the focus of the struggle. Is that focus of the struggle to be on the masses and the material and political conditions of their existence? Or is it on the concept of the people, a loosely defined term embracing all of the oppressed, irrespective of class divisions or class position, and irrespective of their relationship to the oppressor? Now, the resolution of that question itself then reacts back on the issue of the nature of the objective of an anti-imperialist struggle. Because the question arises, independence for what? What is the character of the society that is being struggled for? Now, these theoretical questions are not abstruse. They're not academic questions. Their resolution has profound effects on the struggle itself, with life and death consequences for the participants, and if the resolution is not adequate to the circumstances, with a devastating effect on the struggle itself. Now, all this, it seems to me, is dramatically demonstrated by the history of the Palestinian Revolution, and by any careful reflection on the prospects and opportunities for that revolution today. And this is an issue from which those engaged in solidarity work with the Palestinian struggle cannot abstain, in my view. In building solidarity with the struggle outside Palestine, activists have two duties, and these are dictated by any serious commitment to the struggle. The first of those duties is to offer unconditional support to Palestinian resistance, irrespective of whether one agrees or disagrees with the objectives of those who are engaged in the struggle themselves, and to explain and indeed to defend the actions of those resisting imperialism. But the second duty is equally important, and that is the duty, if we take the struggle seriously, not to see solidarity work merely as an addendum to the struggle, a kind of moral obligation that we have to identify with the oppressed, much less as a substitute for the struggle of the oppressed themselves, but rather to understand it, solidarity work, to understand solidarity work as part of the struggle, part of the whole of the struggle. One wing, in other words, of what is, in effect, a common project. That itself entails a duty, I would want to argue, and I'm arguing here, to criticize, to reflect, to share ideas, to consider alternatives, and to debate the questions of the objective, the strategy for its attainment, the tactics to be used, and to debate that with those most directly involved in the struggle. And that is summed up in the slogan for anyone engaged in solidarity acting, and that is unconditional support for the struggle of the oppressed, but critical support for those involved in the struggle. In other words, engaging in criticism when one takes issue with either the objectives or the strategy. This has been repeated again and again in struggles against colonialism in South Asia, in Africa, against apartheid in Southern Africa, against Britain in Ireland, and today, I think, equally in the case of Palestine, in the struggle in Palestine for its freedom, and also in the struggle against the reactionary Arab regimes. The argument that I want to make, and I will briefly outline as a kind of provocation to debate and discussion, I think can be fairly easily summarized. The first part of that argument is this, that the history of the Palestinian struggle is replete with lessons about this, that the aspiration of the main Palestinian force for decades, Fatah, the aspiration for an independent capitalist Palestine, joining, in other words, with the other Arab regimes, was in the face of the support of Western imperialism for the Zionist project, and in the face of the reluctance of the Arab regimes to sacrifice their own interests for Palestinian liberation, was a struggle always unlikely to be attainable, an unattainable objective. So that's the first part of the argument that I want to make. The second part is that the defeat of what I would describe as the quasi-Maoist strategy of guerrilla armed struggle, in other words, summed up by the Maoist slogan, power comes from the barrel of a gun, and that the defeat of the strategy of a negotiated compromise with Zionism in the form of the two-state solution coming out of Oslo, etc., the so-called peace process, left the Palestinian Revolution in a situation in which Israel found itself confirmed in its determination both to neutralize and to use as a means of disrupting and dividing the Palestinian Revolution and the Palestinian resistance in the way that has happened since. In other words, we now find ourselves, I would suggest, in a situation where that revolution is at an historical low point as measured from, let's say, the 1970s onwards and to today. That, I think, is the assessment that I would make of where the revolution is at the moment. The third point that I would make is this, that if this is an historical low for the revolution, for that struggle at the moment, on the ground in Palestine, nevertheless, it is also a moment of opportunity in which an understanding is now possible of the interdependence of the Palestinian struggle with the regional struggles for democracy and for justice of the Arab masses in the area. And between these two struggles, the Palestinian struggle and the struggle of the Arab masses, between them and the struggle against austerity and neoliberalism, both in the global north and the global south. If the Arab Spring, as it has been called, would be better referred to as an awakening of the street and of the factory, then this, arguably, for Palestine, is an awakening of the Palestinian Revolution. And what I mean by an awakening is a realization that objective and strategy are intertwined. They are not separate. You cannot choose a strategy independently of identifying its relationship to an objective. Secondly, a realization that a strategy founded on a model of Arab nationalism has become, arguably has been for some time, an anachronism. And that the slogan, "The road to Jerusalem lies through Cairo," in other words, that the victory of the Palestinian Revolution depends not on oligarchs and generals and princes of the Arab kingdoms and the remnants of the state capitalist republican dictatorships, but on an alliance with the Arab masses. And if this is true, even if it is only part of the picture, then this has profound implications for the future of the Palestinian Revolution. As Omar Barghouti of the Boycott National Committee and of the Palestinian Campaign for the Academic and Cultural Boycott of Israel, as Omar Barghouti has argued, the current Palestinian leadership is, and I quote him, in total disarray. And, I quote him again, inherently incapable of any effective resistance strategy. The Palestine Liberation Organization, as another Palestinian commentator has remarked, has lost the spirit of revolution and has collapsed into the tool of the Zionist state. That's not me saying this. This is a Palestinian commentator on the struggle in which she is involved. The Oslo peace process was, of course, for the Palestinians, nothing short of a disaster. The Palestinian Authority became something in quasi-existence, a fragmented and limited state with what could be described at best as partial home rule, allowed the continued gradual annexation of land in the West Bank with an inexorably developing apartheid-like discrimination against Palestinians therein to match the discrimination against Palestinians inside pre-1967 Israel. And, of course, with Israel's long-term objective of annexation, and medium-term use of the Palestinian Authority to continue divisions in the Palestinian Revolution. In this, the Palestinian Authority became complicit through the policing of the territories, through the administration of local authorities, all working with the Israeli army to maintain order. All of this produced an intensification of class division within Palestinian society. Palestinian officials and sections of the Palestinian elite enriching themselves through the allocation of contracts and their relationships with external capital that was seeking investment opportunities in the West Bank. Thus, it has arguably, and I am arguing, been the emphasis of Fatah on national unity and consequently in turning away from any radical social project in Palestine as the objective of the revolution. The objective is national unity rather than anything else. That it is this that has undermined the capacity of the movement to develop organic links with the movement of the masses in Egypt and the rest of the Arab world, or to resist the imposition of neoliberalism in the occupied territories themselves. As was argued yesterday in the meeting on the boycott, disinvestment, and sanctions movement, it was, in fact, the eruption of BDS as a Palestinian call for solidarity that began the process of breaking with the traditional Palestinian leadership and understanding revolution not as something located tightly within the borders of the nation, but as a global process, not an autonomous struggle against Zionism, but part of a more general struggle, not for the sake of it being an ideal objective, but for that being a necessary strategic orientation for success. The issue here, then, for the Palestinian Revolution is how the anti-imperialist struggle against Zionism is to be conducted. Is it to be through linking that struggle to the social struggle of the peasants and workers of the Arab world, or will it be through a continued subordination of social struggle, both in the Arab world and in Palestine itself, a subordination of the social struggle to the national struggle? We have seen the ways in which subordination of the issue of class and privilege have led to the assimilation of parts of the Palestinian leadership to the dominant powers. The question now is, what will secular leftists and the Palestinian masses make of the strategic choices, the tactical decisions, and the question of what the objective of that liberation is all about?
Introduce our second speaker now, who is Professor Karma Nabulsi, who is currently teaches at Oxford and is a long-term Palestinian campaigner. And Karma will speak for 20 minutes.
Thank you. I'm going to speak about a couple of things about the... Can everybody hear me? No? You can't? Okay. How about that? Okay. I'll lean into the mic. I'd like to talk to you about a couple of things today about the Palestinian Revolution. It has a long history. The state of play of our forces, our strength, our unity is, I would say, at its lowest ebb since I've been involved in the Palestinian movement. But I'd like to talk to you about a couple of the things that unite us and keep us together. And I'd like to talk about just one of the campaigns which unite the Palestinians, because Tom gave a very good analysis about what you support and what solidarity is. And I would go a little bit further, because I think always there's a lot of you that are old campaigners, not old, but campaigning, have campaigned for a very long time for this struggle. It's a long struggle. It's a just cause. And I see generation now after generation of young people coming to struggles for justice and equality on a range of issues, who learn through coming to the Palestinian cause, because it is a difficult one, because it's not in our hand right away, but we are very confident in the sense that once you learn about the Palestinian struggle, it helps you join other struggles for justice and equality. So it's been a great honor, really, to be a Palestinian in the movement and to grow up in it, in the extraordinary solidarity work that was happening between other national liberation movements, not all of them revolutionary, but many revolutionaries inside of them, from the ANC and SWAPO and Farabundo and across the world, and now in our university campuses in this country and other places. So what I'd like to talk about is the two goals that the Palestinian people have. I won't go into the history, but the one important feature of that history, of that extraordinary history of the last century of resistance, is really about against the ethnic cleansing and against the Nakba, which is the catastrophe, which happened between 1947 and 1949, where the majority of us were expelled from our land. And I'm from a refugee family from Lebanon, but that's So more than just thinking about the people inside Palestine who are struggling there now in different types of regimes, in Jerusalem and Gaza, West Bank and Gaza, 48 Palestine, where you have people living under different types of legislative occupation, colonialism, apartheid, and discrimination, I'd like to talk about the Palestinian people as a whole, because it is their struggle, and the majority of us are struggling outside of the borders of historic Palestine. So the cause is very simple for us, and it was when I joined, it was in my dad's time, and that was liberation and return. Liberation of our land, our return to it. I'm one of those that think that the land belongs to the people that come from there, and I believe that the future is for the people. Once the Palestinians can return, whatever structure, however many states, no state, federation, whatever, I'm easy. I believe that it's the people themselves that should determine their political structures. But after the injustice has been corrected, and the injustice which was legislated in the General Assembly Resolution 194, which was the return of all refugees that choose to do so to their home. Yeah. So that's the core of our struggle. Yeah, we have a refugee people. And that cause is not a refugee cause. We're not an interest group. We're not a sector. We're part of the Palestinian people. It is a popular cause. So those that were not expelled, the refugee issue is their issue in the same way. Everybody, every family has been fragmented under Zionism and this policy of expulsion and colonialism that goes on into this day. And in fact, we always say the Nakba continues. And you can see the policies of colonialism and ethnic cleansing every day. Yeah, in Jerusalem, for example, but in other parts of historic Palestine and outside of it. And I'm going to close with a little film, just a little two-minute clip of one of this campaign that I was involved in, which are now on the borders of Syria and Turkey, in Mohaim Handarat camp, which were from the north part of Syria. We've had a destroyed community there, that's a refugee community that's been there since 1948 in Syria, 500,000 strong, and it's now utterly demolished and dispersed all over in Turkey and Lebanon and elsewhere in Jordan. So these two goals, 20 years after, some more than 20 years after Oslo, Palestinians find ourselves much further from these goals. Not one liberty has been won, nor one inch of land liberated. Instead, we have faced a continuation of the loss of our land and of our sovereignty over it. So there's a long list of reasons for that. I'm not going to go into that. Lots of good books in it. I don't really have enough time. I'm just going to try and talk for a few minutes about a couple of these concepts so we can talk about it in the questions and answers. But the thing that people look at a lot when studying what's happened to Palestine and the colonialism and the ethnic cleansing and what the Zionist project has done is the takeover of our land, not only our expulsion of it. But less is really known about what's happened to us as a people and the imprisonment of ourselves as a people. And so that's what I just wanted to show you so you can get an idea of what's happened. In 1995, there was something, the Palestinian Authority, which was meant to be a temporary authority, was created for 5 years. Yeah, and there was before that the Palestine Liberation Organization, which was an umbrella organization that the resistance movements took over. It was set up in 64. By 1969, the revolution had gone into the PLO and taken it over, and it became like any of those broad popular front liberation movements where you had everything from the right to, indeed, you had some Maoists, and you had even communists and Fatah, actually. But what you had was a liberation movement in which you had Marxists, socialists, leftists, secularists, Islamists, all working, lots of ideologies in a popular front. And it was very similar to the other liberation movements of the day. And that's where the concept of the armed struggle came from, in the sense that it was embedded in that era of the 60s and 70s, where many people, basically from the Algerian FLN, which was that struggle to liberate and to return. Yeah. So this was the old PLO, very kind of simple design, because it needed to be, you know, we were dispersed from 48, so this was created in 65. It needed to be elastic enough to hold all this range of ideologies, resistance movements, and people living in Gaza, in Jerusalem, in the West Bank, in 48, in Lebanon, in Kuwait, in Latin America. Yeah, and there was the Palestine National Council, which is our parliament in exile. And in fact, in Latin America, we have a big community, and they were running elections to elect their members to the Palestine National Council. So we have a supreme legislative body there. So what's happened after Oslo, that I can send anybody if they want. Konrad Adenauer, one of those NGOs, kind of tried to break it down. It's kind of fiendish, because what's happened in there is now there's the PA, which actually the foreign donors have started funding, which is this interim temporary body that was meant to last 5 years. Yeah? And that's it. That's what they've created just in the West Bank and Gaza, which is the minority of a smaller percentage of our people, with its own legislative council, which can't meet, et cetera, et cetera. So there you go. If you want to talk about a trap and the loss of popular sovereignty, not only, this is what I wanted to explain, not only should you look at the land and the settlements and the encroachments and the checkpoints and the imprisonments and the expropriations, but you need to understand this too. When you understand, where is the Palestinian liberation movement? Where is the masses, right? Because here you have this, and I'll show you what happens here. Right, nobody can make sense of it. We are all, it's entirely bewildering. Look at these arrows, and this is one of those foreign donors that we're trying to figure it out, the ones that have been funding the PA, yeah? Down here you have the Palestinian people. There is no attachment between these institutions. I mean, it's classic colonial method, but it's so fiendish, it's so complicated. None of us can get out of this trap. So when you look at the occupation, of the dispossession, of the control over the land, of our people struggling in prisons, in refugee camps, you know, the idea to disperse us, to not allow us to unify, to struggle, yeah? This is actually what you're facing here. So how do you support? Do you support the PA? It's a state. Do you support? No, you support the Palestinian people in their struggle for the principles that all Palestinians believe in. So how can you hear the Palestinian people? Yeah. Oh, that's the last one. That's even more insane. Yeah. So I'd just like to talk about, how much time have I got? I'm about halfway. So, yeah, I just want to talk about one thing, because, you know, there's a big debate amongst Palestinians is, when did the revolution die, right? And we have a great history. We have a great revolutionary history, because our predicament is revolutionary. And only a liberation movement is the only model that can allow us to achieve our goals, right? None of us, I mean, when I joined the movement, none of us were fighting for a state. We were fighting for liberation in return. We were fighting for justice. Yeah, all the people that came and fought with us were fighting for justice. All the people we went and fought with were fighting for justice, for equality, for the goals that we all held dear and the principles. And that, for me, is the hallmark and the experience that I went through of tens of thousands of cadres, that it wasn't a state-building project. Yeah? It was about liberation in return. So the thing that I'd like to talk about, which is encapsulated in that revolutionary predicament, is a concept which is an experience concept and isn't an obscure one. We were talking about obscure concepts here before, and that's popular sovereignty. There was a lovely 19th century French revolutionary, 1830s, called Godefroy Cavaignac. His elder brother actually turned into a very bad army man and suppressed the people in 1848. But Cavaignac was an extraordinary, and he wrote something about la force révolutionnaire, revolutionary force. Where does it come from? And he talks about it, the engine, revolutionary engine, comes from the masses, but it comes from the understanding of popular sovereignty, that the people are sovereign, that the people determine themselves. Right? And that's been the main Palestinian quest. How can we determine ourselves? How can we free ourselves? That engine of popular sovereignty is something that when you're looking at, well, where is the Palestinian cause? What are they fighting to? Okay, here's the two principles. But a lot of people are saying, well, they don't want to return to their land anymore. A lot of people in the, you know, the Western donors, the Americans are saying, oh, well, they don't really want to return. It's just about, you know, statelet in the West Bank and Gaza. So one example of that, which I wanted to talk about, is last March, small campaign I was involved in. It wasn't a small campaign, it was a really gorgeous campaign that I was involved in, which was Return Unifies Us, which was that first, that was the poster for it. Yeah. And that was on the day, that was when there was actually quite a lot of, there was quite a big push, international push, about the right of return, and everybody's always saying the Palestinians have to compromise and they have to give up on the right of return if they want, you know, partial sovereignty on 20% of their land. Yeah, and that it was somehow something that wasn't an essential part of who we are as a people, our right to return to our land, and it wasn't inside us, and we were ready to give up. We were ready to surrender. Yeah? So there was a mobilization that happened over just 4 weeks. And what's really interesting in it is that the declaration that came out and the events that was held over that one action day was launched on the anniversary of the Battle of Karame. And the Battle of Karame has quite historic significance for the Palestinians in the late 60s. 1968, it was the beginning of, it was when some of the Palestinian fighters held off the Israelis and in a small town, the Battle of Karame. And it became an epic moment for us because it was about standing up against larger forces. How long have I got? 5 minutes. Okay. Larger forces. And it was the big mobilizing moment, that battle, in which everybody came, all the young people came to join the struggle. Right, so it has a lot of memory and resonance for those who had been in the revolution and that. And it was just shortly after that the fighters and the resistance movement took over the PLO, that institution I showed you in the beginning. And of course, once the revolution went into the PLO and took it over, the people came after and it became popular and it became filled with the unions and other activities. So this action day was on the day of the 46th anniversary of the Battle of Karama. And it talked about how during this battle, our people forged the path towards, I'm trying to do it from Arabic to English, it's a bit, the language doesn't. Our people proudly forged the path towards the return to our beloved homeland. This historic moment showed that it is by insistence on the unity and cohesion of our people everywhere, the unity of their struggle, the oneness of their destiny, that the right of return to their homes of origin and other national principles can be achieved. And this was in the height of the attacks on Yarmouk camp in Syria and other places. Now, the national, there's a website and you can see all of the signatories, but the great coalitions signed on, big coalitions, the National Islamic Forces in Palestine, the Coalition for Jerusalem, which is huge, the Palestinian Scouts and Guides Federation, which is everywhere. This is in Yarmouk camp. They couldn't print that poster. Everywhere else they printed the poster. This is in Nablus, which shows inside Palestine is outside, return unifies us. Yeah? And they marched out of Balata camp, which is the largest camp in the West Bank, and most of the people from Jaffa, actually. They marched up the hill into Nablus on that slogan, return unifies us. And they had meetings, and the constituent members, the Global Right of Return Coalition, and I think about 150 associations, organizations, unions, right across the Palestinian spectrum, signed on to this in the first 10 days. And so what they managed to organize, there's in Latin America, Australia, everywhere, this extraordinary day. And I'd just like to close, because I've got, if I get one more minute. There was some people we were talking to, and I told you about Syria. We have this decimated community there. And in fact, they're not allowing Palestinian refugees into Lebanon. They allow Syrian refugees. They won't allow Palestinian refugees into Jordan. They allow Syrian refugees. A lot had ended up around the Aleppo region. All of the camps were destroyed there, and they ended up on the Turkish border. And they wanted to participate. They wanted to participate in this day of action on the right of return. And they actually sent a video, which I'd like to show you, and it's got subtitles, so the subtitles come up quite low. Let's see if I can do this. I'm just going to take it back so you can see this. This is in a shelter.
رسالة يوجهون للعالم الصادق عن معاناتهم ومأساتهم.
Thank you very much. My name is Yusuf. I'm from Jaffa, from Palestine. I want to say that the right of return is in our blood. Even if Israel or anyone kill all the Palestinians, but the spirit of the right of return will still exist. Another thing, if we are talking about resistance, and this is the title of our meeting today, although we are a little bit disappointed because of what's happening now in the PLO or with the PA in the West Bank, but again, there is a kind of hope. There is something that we call it al-Hirak, a movement. More than 10 days ago, when Khadr Adnan was on a strike and he was in hospital in Sarafand, facing death, young people, many, and all of them are seculars, Christian, Muslims, Palestinians, came and gave him solidarity. And this is a kind of resistance also. And I think even the idea of boycott Israel is now giving its effect. And this is a wonderful idea. But you need to understand that Palestinians alone cannot reach the deliberate of Palestine without your help by really boycott this fascist state. And last thing that I want to say, to realize that Palestine is not only the West Bank. This is the problem that I'm facing here in Europe. People insist that Palestine, Ramallah, the villages around Jerusalem. No, Palestine is Yafa, Haifa, Akka. This is Palestine. Thank you.
Yeah, I just want to emphasize the return argument. It's absolutely central, and there will never be a settlement unless that is properly addressed, and we all need to be really conscious of that. But I also want to pick up on the last speaker and very much echo the strategic dimension, which is the Palestinians aren't simply fighting Israel. They're fighting a conglomerate, which is, I call, United States, European Union, Israel. The Palestinians cannot defeat that by themselves. The question of, and I understand this sentiment of unity, this kind of genuinely revolutionary, heroic sentiment of ourselves alone. And it's absolutely justified, and as Kamal said, it's the most revolutionary people on the planet. But the question of strategic alliance is absolutely central, both in terms of the Arab world and the implications of the Egyptian revolution. And the moment when the refugee camps themselves began to mobilize in the context of the Arab Spring and began to march on the border. And apparently one or two actually got through. I saw a wonderful story, which had been written up, a young Palestinian woman from one of the camps actually got to Jaffa, somehow evaded the Israeli authorities, just one. But nevertheless, the symbolism of that is absolutely enormous. That just happened recently. So let's not get demoralized by the present, understandably demoralized situation. This is a people that's going to go on fighting all sorts of ways. But I've only got a couple of minutes. I just want to stress one thing. For us, BDS in this country, so important. I just wanted to ask Tom if the Unjam Mirza story was told yesterday. Right, Unjam Mirza, some of you may know him, is a comrade, Socialist Workers Party comrade, is a railway worker, RMT officer, and he wore a Palestinian badge 8 or 9 months ago, and he was immediately suspended on full pay for wearing this badge on the grounds it was anti-Semitic. And this is a really interesting story. He then, because he knew about the struggle that all of us, especially in the UCU, Union of College and Lecturers Union, had been involved in for many years with the Zionists, and the fact that Zionists took our union to court to get a ruling on whether anti-Zionism equals anti-Semitism. We were fantastically nervous because our union wasn't...
Can you sum up, please, comrade?
Sorry?
Can you sum up as well? It's 3 minutes.
It's up already?
Yeah.
Okay. The point of the story is Unjam downloaded this ruling, summarised it, took it to the hearing, and they dropped it. And he's back wearing the badge at work.
Comrades in the white shirt at the back, white T-shirt.
Jeff Hurst from South Wales. If I can respond to the first speaker that said the Palestinians cannot do this alone, and say a little bit more about the demonstration that we have coming up on the 6th of September in Cardiff, which is a particular opportunity. It's a particular opportunity to extend the BDS campaign and the cultural campaign and the universities campaign into the area of sport, which is something which, you know, I don't think we've really had very much opportunity to do in this country. And it, you know, when that one, because it's just the luck of the draw as to how, you know, who's in what group, it could be many, many years before this comes round again, where Israel is drawn, although one hopes it's shortened by the fact that Israel will cease to exist. However, in the meantime, say on the 6th of September, we will be holding a march that will actually go from the City Hall in the centre of Cardiff, where last year we had a 5,000 strong march in support of Gaza, and we hope to be able to repeat, with your help, those sort of numbers. It will actually go to the ground itself. There's fortunately a park right alongside the ground, which means that something like 30,000 people, it'll be a sellout crowd, 30,000 people will go past and will be seen and want to know why you're there. And we've already done preparation work in terms of leafleting the ground, and we'll be doing that in the early matches. What's even more important, of course, something of this kind, which is unusual, which is going to get publicity anybody, will go around not merely this country, but will go around the world. And it will actually, you know, put another little marker down, another small but very important contribution. It's something else one can build on. There is a, I've got leaflets here which we'll give out at the end. There's also a motion that can be put to trade unions. We have sort of local trade union support in Wales, also local support from councillors. And Cardiff Council. So what I would urge you, please, is to go, you know, back to where you came from, and raise this, and raise this issue. I'm sure many have already involved in the PSC or other campaigns, but clearly, you know, you wanted to be talking to other groups in the area to arrange transport. Get down, it's a Sunday, nice and easy for travelling, and even actually if you want to come for the weekend, we can probably put you up in Cardiff. But sort of, you know, I think, please, it is a matter, it is a particular opportunity, so I hope actually all of you respond. Thank you.
Hi, I don't know if what I'm going to say is appropriate for this actual meeting, but I need to say it because I made a promise to the people in Gaza. I was asked by one of the youth activists there, a Gazan, if when I came to London, I would ask the people of England if they would help them to get money released from Fatah to pay their doctors and nurses and teachers in Gaza who haven't been paid for maybe up to a year, and they're all working to keep the infrastructure going with no money. How they're surviving, I honestly don't know, but they are beseeching the people in the West, in Europe in particular, in Canada, America, Australia, anywhere, to put pressure on Fatah to release this money to Hamas. And that's all I have to say. And I feel I've done my duty for the people of Palestine.
Yeah, I'd not intended to speak at this meeting because I'm certainly no expert on Palestine. I'm quite late to it. But I wanted to say a couple of words about maybe how we in the UK can relate to this thing. And what prompted me was being involved last year in the fantastic series of demonstrations that went worldwide. Incredible shows of solidarity all around the world for Palestinians. In Oxford, where I'm from, there was a series of demonstrations over a period of a week, largely organised by young women students. Young women students have got on Facebook and organised these fantastic 500-600-700 strong demos that marched all around Oxford. Now, I think in that fantastic show of solidarity are the roots to the way forward for Palestine. You know, that kind of international solidarity and bringing that to bear on the Zionist state. Second thing I wanted to say was I don't think we can understand Palestine where it is today outside of understanding it in terms of imperialism today, the stage of imperialism today. If you went to Klinikos's meeting last, you'll know all about imperialism now. If you didn't go, catch it on SWP YouTube. It was brilliant. And the point that he predominantly made was that imperialism means an extended period of massive instability and crisis between warring nationalisms, between people who don't agree with each other. And that kind of thing opens up all sorts of spaces in which we can show solidarity and struggle together. And I think we need to, when we're talking about Palestine, we need to talk about it in the context of imperialism today. Last point, how do we relate to people in terms of the struggle? Because, you know, we're not going to get an opportunity to show the sort of solidarity that we show episode last year every few months or so. But what we can do is we can relate to the people who are on that demonstration in all sorts of other protests that we're likely to meet them. As I said at the beginning, the series of demonstrations in Oxford were organised largely by young students. Well, blow me down, young students are being massively attacked by the Tory government and austerity. These people are likely to be on the same demonstrations. We need to include the Palestinian struggle in our struggles against austerity and anything else.
My name is Norman. I'm from Walthamstow in East London, and I think this is a personal experience. I was in the West Bank in April this year with a team of 30 UK volunteers from Amos Trust, a human rights charity. And I think several things that have been said here have touched me. And I think I've been there four times now in the last 10 years, 8 years. And always the same message I will have to bring back, and it's about conscience as well. Please tell everyone about us. We feel so forgotten. So in April, we went out there. We were based in Bethlehem, and we were working at a refugee camp called Al-Aru between Bethlehem and Hebron. And the project was to help rebuild a demolished Palestinian home. Now, in that process, we employed Palestinian builders to help the local economy. And I think for me personally, it's a real human thing to do. And I would encourage as many people as possible, if you get the opportunity or look for the opportunity, to go out for yourself and see the injustices on the ground. Thank you.
There aren't actually that many people with their hands up, so if anybody has got a question or contribution, I'd really encourage you to speak.
I just want to echo some of the points already made. I think the moral case for the Palestinians is absolutely clear. And I think that is working in Scotland in the Palestine support organisations and such like. It is a predominant feeling on the left that, you know, that the Palestinians deserve and require support, and that liberation and right of return are central. I think the question is how we get there, and I think the comrade who spoke before about the nature of imperialism, I think, is really important, because actually solidarity is critical, BDS is critical, I think that what we do in this country is critical, but it needs to go beyond that, actually. And actually, you know, and as people have argued, I think the Palestinians, in terms of their own struggle, are going to have a huge difficulty in beating the forces of imperialism and Zionism in Israel. And just one point I probably do need to pick up. I mean, Israel is many, many, many things. It's not a fascist state. I think we have to be clear that there's a distinction between what is fascism and what is brutal colonial imperialism. So I think that's just one small point. But I think the wider context is in the discussion I was in at the previous meeting about the development of the revolutions across the Arab world. What's happened in relation to the Arab Spring? And very much the argument is that this is a process, and there are ups and downs in this process, and there's a brutal set of imperial contradictions and conflicts within the Middle East, which actually I think is the situation and difficulty which the Palestinians need to struggle with, and the struggles need to be linked up, because actually the politics, and I think Tom referred to earlier on, the politics of national liberation of Fatah, you know, over a number of years, the politics of the left, the secular left within the Arab world, have failed largely. And I think we need to think about how we move beyond that to actually link up the Palestinian struggle with the struggle of the masses in the Arab world, and through that process actually build a new dynamic revolutionary left that can actually see that liberation in for the Palestinians is going to involve the liberation of the Egyptian working class, of the Tunisian working class, of the masses across the Arab world who are actually facing huge problems. And I think that is the kind of the the hope for the future is that, and I think at the moment, I think we are at a historical low, and I think that is problematic. And I think the issue is how we actually sustain the confidence amongst activists, not just here, but in Palestine, to see that there is actually potential for the way forward. We can't tell what will happen because actually eruptions can blow up at any point. So actually the movement can shift and change, and I think it may be at a low point just now, but we need to build for that point where actually there will be an upswing and an upturn in the struggle.
I think I should talk about the something that we were doing locally last year in the middle of while the mass demonstrations were going on in London in support of the people of Gaza. We decided that in Haringey Justice for Palestinian that we really need to become local. So we arranged with a local mosque to have a meeting on a Thursday evening. We had 70 people in the mosque, and we'd advertised it as widely as we could all over the place, leafleting everywhere. But at that meeting, we decided to have a demonstration in Wood Green, and for one of the best demonstrations I've ever been on for a particular reason. But we had 380 people. We counted them marching through Wood Green High Road on a Saturday afternoon. To the most terrific support from local people. The slogans that we were shouting on the demonstration were being shouted back at us from the side of the road. And I don't mean just the local Muslim population either. It was a really a brilliant demonstration, and it's the sort of thing we were able to do. But Haringey Justice for Palestinians started off thinking we've got to try and make something local, and that's what we did.
Yeah, I think if you talk about the fate of the Palestinian revolution, you have to talk about where the power is going to come from to really do that, which a couple of people have referred to, because it's one thing to say that, which is true, that the Israeli state is a set up as a tool of imperialism and so on, but we shouldn't fall then into the trap of, oh, there's this almighty force and there's really nothing you can do about it. But what the Arab uprisings in 2011 showed us is that there is a force that can challenge that, and that force lies in an enormously powerful working class that exists across the region. And therefore I think that connecting those struggles is very, very important, but also politically fighting for leadership within that, because you're absolutely right, there are political leadership questions both within Palestine itself. Do you settle for a national state, or do we push for liberation? But this is also fantastically true within the Arab revolutions. Do you settle for taking over the existing state, or do we push for smashing through and building a socialist society, which in my opinion the fate of the Palestinian revolution is 100% tied up with? And how do we give support to that process from over here? Because there are several things that are really important. First, it's really important that the Palestinians themselves have resisted and keep resisting. You know, people talked about the fantastic demonstrations last year. They wouldn't happen if the Palestinians themselves hadn't resisted and kept on resisting, and it's fantastically important that that has happened. It's then important that we support that in any way we can. The boycott, divestment, sanctions campaign, absolutely we should be doing what we can, the demonstrations in Cardiff. But we can also contribute to that political debate about the way forward, and I think that's very, very important as well. There's going to be a massive demonstration in outside the Tory party conference on October the 4th, and I hope everyone's going to go and be building coaches. And somebody said before, the people who are angry over here, who look and see what's happening in Palestine, and they very much associate their own struggles over it. Somebody talked in a previous meeting about the connections that were made between people in Ferguson complaining about the shooting of Michael Brown, and how they were sharing on Facebook with Palestinians, how do you deal with tear gas? We're facing these tear gas canisters were made by the same people that are being used against us in Gaza and are being used against us in Ferguson. So people, it's a generalizing political issue for people over here. And when we go to Manchester, we have to make that demonstration internationalist, in favor of welcoming refugees, in fact against imperialism. We have to strike a blow against our government as a way of helping the anti-imperialist cause in the Middle East.
Hello, I'm a comrade from the Dutch IS, and we've been organizing an academic boycott in the universities in Amsterdam, and actually it's the first academic boycott that's ever been talked about, and actually got conceded to by the board of the Amsterdam universities when we first wanted to start to organize a meeting in a coalition called something like Students for the Justice of Palestine. Then it was right after Charlie Hebdo, and they tried to, for the sake of free speech, ban the meeting. So, and then we got moved, and then we got into the press. And then our group was really small, it was like a handful of people, but we had sympathizers. And then we got into the press for being banned, and we had a very prominent SP member who was... who left the SP over Palestine because the SP stopped supporting Gaza in the last war. I hope I can make this brief. Anyway, then because of this public attention, we could organize a second meeting where we got a full room, we got academic speakers, we got to put in our own story, we got to speak first as well. Yeah, that's important. Because you know you're going to have time, come on. And we got a load of young students, it doesn't matter if they're blonde, women, men, from Arab descent, any kind of descent, all these people wanted to know, what can we do? What kind of solution is there? We even had CD people for the propagandist for Israel sitting in the room making a mockery of themselves, and just the people who were on the fence turned against them and said, we support the Palestinian cause. So that's the first start, that's the first step. I'm going to wrap up. But we had massive demonstrations in Amsterdam, and now we're moving to the academic and cultural boycott. And we even had Omar Barghouti speaking in the universities for an organization called Gate 48. So we're improving, and we're going to step up, and we're going to stop the cooperation between Amsterdam and Tel Aviv.
Hey, I'm Louis. I'm quite new to the movement, obviously. I haven't really been around long. So I just want to return to the original question of what the future of the revolution is, and find out what ordinary people like me, I'm a student, I haven't really got much time or influence, and I want to know what we can do on a daily basis, and I don't know, on big demonstrations, what we can do to support Palestine and get it back into the press, because people forget about what's happening. Like, when there's a big massacre in Gaza, it's all over the news, and then after about a week, it's back to someone's gone down in dress size in the Daily Mail, and everyone's raving about that. So I want to know how we can keep it as a central issue and what we can do to fight for Palestine.
Hello. My name is Nader, they call me Shahid, witness. And I was in a Palestinian refugee camp in Lebanon. And I'm currently settling here. I want to offer the solution for the immigration in Europe of a million of Palestinian. If we send them back home, we can solve part of this problem. Million of Palestinians in Lebanon, I don't want to illustrate a lot about what's happening there, you may know, and also in Syria, in Yarmouk and other camps. Whatever what is happening, we all know that our road is very long and better, more. So we know that. At the same time, we know that resistance, it's not war, it's not conflict, it's resistance against occupation, always win. However, the cost can be too much, but we are ready to take it. We are ready to sacrifice more for the right of the Palestinian, all of us, the young and the elder, and to get back to our land. I want to talk about some kind of things that Palestinian, you can bet at this. Palestinian all over the place, wait from the Western Union, maybe let's talk about Britain. And we have taught, we have learned a little bit about the history and Balfour Declaration and all of that. So if we want to start step by step, if people and history book told us that Britain is the main cause of your suffer, we expect first of all people to get out and shout and having something like apology for Balfour Declaration. And I think this could happen in this time. And the second thing I want to talk about is, as my friend Yusuf was telling, it's not just Gaza and the West Bank. I'm from Akka, I'm from Zeeb, they call it Akhazib, they try to change names. So it's all Palestine, and a lot of people say to me sometime here, a lot of Israeli giving the Palestinian right and something like that. And to be more specific, if anybody knew what's happening there and they are sitting there, I want to use this panel to advise them to leave and go out of Palestine, and then we can talk. And I want to start from this panel also. If you knew anybody like that, it's not too much wrong. They usually have access to Europe and to have access to USA or other countries, while Palestinian don't have any access outside of Gaza or even Yarmouk or anything. So they can contribute in their human part in that, and this is kind of responsibility. This is kind of responsibility at you at Britain to contribute more, and thanks for everything that people taking the responsibility as a human and do. But we can do more, we can do more all together, and you can bet at Palestinian. Thank you.
So I will call back in both of the speakers for 5 minutes each, starting with Karma.
Thank you for all your interventions. That was really extraordinary to listen to everybody's commitment and knowledge about this cause. Where's Louis? There was a question. Yes, what can we do? I mean, I didn't talk a lot about the boycott because I think, did you have a panel on it? Yeah, but also, you know, it goes back to there's the principles behind which you boycott Israel until it applies justice to the various Palestinian communities that make up the whole, one of those being the right of return for the refugees. And so when I was talking about that, it was just about the action you take come from the love of justice and equality and struggle. And so that's the most important way of connecting people to Palestine. So when you say, what can you do? There's so many ways of making the Palestinians visible. That's our struggle, is to make the Palestinians visible, because all of the media are trying to make us invisible. Yeah. So there's a number of organizations and associations that are struggling on the ground, inside Palestine, outside Palestine, in the refugee camps. So there's been some really successful things about, like, bringing ex-prisoners over with the prisoners organization, because just having people to come and hear the stories of what is going on. Once people learn about Palestine, they attach themselves to the struggle. I've never found anyone that didn't know about it. And then when you start telling them the story, this very human story about the injustices, they say the same thing that some of you have said: what can we do? And, you know, most Palestinians will know you know, some work on one level, that one level is never enough. We need to work on every single level. We need to work on big campaigns, on small ones, on humanitarian issues, on everything that we can do to keep raising Palestine. It's such an exemplar of universalism in its struggle and in its history. And there is a particular history in this country, which is the origins of Zionism, the origins of colonialism, and the project happen here. And so there is a particular understanding that I found people from Britain have, and it's very important that the young generation know the history. Every Palestinian knows British history. Every Palestinian. I grew up having to learn about the White Paper, the Crane Commission, the Balfour Declaration. I'm sure, Yusuf, you'll remember that. We knew everything. And I remember when I first came here, some British people didn't know. And I was like, read your history, learn the history, because it's also that attachment of that common joint struggle against injustice. So I just want to say thank you for all of your work all through the year. It matters. It matters to us so much. Everybody can hear the solidarity in the demonstrations, in the small gestures and the big ones, BDS, in the academic arenas, but in the supermarkets. It's a really concrete, tangible gesture which says we're on the side of justice. Thank you.
I really want to thank Karma for a number of things. Not least, I never thought that I'd turn up to a meeting discussing Palestine and to hear the reference to the French philosopher Cavaignac. But I suppose that's to be expected from one of the world's most renowned scholars on Rousseau. But I also want to thank Karma for a different reason, because of telling us about the campaign, the Return Unifies Us campaign. It's a campaign that I actually didn't know about, and I think I should have known about it. But I want to make reference to that because there is a sense, given that what her argument, what Karma's argument was in respect of that campaign, was about the way in which Palestinians in toto can be unified and must be unified and need to be unified around the right of return, you might think, sits slightly uncomfortably with my argument about the tension between national unity in the Palestinian Revolution on the one hand and a concentration on a different kind of national unity, a national unity that recognizes social divisions. Because there are two kinds, of course, of national unity. There's a national unity that is based on the suppression of dissent and ignoring social division, and there's a national unity that comes from a unity around what is of key importance for the vast majority of the population, for the masses. But I don't think that there was a contradiction at all between the notion, the slogan, the name of the campaign, Return Unites Us, on the one hand, and the things that I was suggesting in criticism of the Palestinian Authority. Because let's make no mistake, the slogan and the name of the campaign, Return Unites Us, is a dagger aimed straight at the heart of the Palestine Authority, which has written out the possibility of the return of the majority of the Palestinians who live outside of historic Palestine. So I think that what is remarkable about that campaign is that without an explicit criticism of what otherwise might be called the sellout of the Palestinian authorities, it actually constitutes the most devastating critique of what has taken place there. Second thing that I wanted to say was I wanted to reply to Louis, who says he hasn't got much time. We all never have much time, but Louis, you will find the time. But I wanted to make some practical suggestions, because it's this issue of keeping the issue of Palestine at the forefront of everybody's minds isn't a question necessarily of keeping it on the headlines of newspapers or on the first line of a news broadcast on television. Yesterday, Jonathan Rosenhead, who is the chair of the British Committee for the Universities of Palestine, who was speaking at the BDS meeting, he said one of the interesting things is the way that our Zionist enemies simply don't understand us. They're always trying to find out where the money comes from that lies behind the BDS campaign that enables us year after year to extend the campaign and win the argument in more and more trade unions, more and more students' unions, more and more campaigning groups.
And he said, what they don't understand, and it's wonderful that they don't understand it, but they never will understand it, even if you tell them, is that we can do it because we're an organization that doesn't have any money. We don't depend on it, money. That's not what we depend on. And Louis, what I would say to you is exactly the same thing is true about building the campaign. I mean, the simplest thing to do, if you're a student or a school student, is go into your classes wearing the Palestinian flag as a badge, having an argument with people, discussing with them, not a nasty argument, explaining, patiently explaining, recounting the history, getting a group of people to share the badge, the wearing of the badge with you, getting them to start thinking about possibly making contact, twinning even with some people in Palestine, some other students or school students in Palestine, twinning with them, maybe even getting parents to agree that you could go on a visit to Palestine and come back and report on it, because that is the way in which this movement is kept going, and which is something that the Zionists don't understand and with which they cannot deal. The third thing that I wanted to say is this, that everyone, many speakers have spoken about the importance for us of the boycott, disinvestment and sanctions campaign. And it is the central part, not just because it's the best thing that we can do, but also because of what it represents in the transformation of the Palestinian revolution itself, the appeal for our solidarity in their support, what that means for them. I want to speak about the importance of pushing that forward. And to address these questions, John Rose, when he spoke about the ways in which we can resist the Zionist pressure. He spoke about the way in which our comrade in the RMT resisted the pressure on him. John spoke about the way that we saw off the legal challenge to ourselves in the UCU when we passed the motion. And if any of you wants the booklet on it, there's a booklet here that outlines how you see off that legal challenge. And it's what the Zionists use. They will stoop to anything in order to reverse the movement, including what they now call lawfare. They don't just call it warfare, they call it lawfare, using the law as a weapon of war to try and cripple our side. But then, it's not just a question of us winning those votes in conferences, in our union branches, in our students' unions. It's also about finding ways in which to implement those decisions when they are taken. Because the existence of Israeli lawfare does mean that even in organizations whose membership votes in favor of a particular policy, the bureaucracies that run them, the executives that govern them, are then scared to take the action that members have voted for as fear of the legal challenge and the financial consequences of the legal challenge are brought to bear. And under those circumstances, we have to go round them. And what that means is, in any organization that has taken such a position, we need to get individuals to say, my organization represents this policy. So I, as the individual that I am, commit myself to supporting that policy. I publicly declare that I will support that policy, and then there is nothing that the Zionists can do against us. Lastly, boycott is about three things. The BDS campaign is about three things, fundamentally. You can split these things up into sub-clauses if you want, but the fundamental thing is the ending of the occupation, the ending of discrimination against Palestinians inside pre-1967 Israeli borders. And thirdly, and most pivotally in my view, it's about the right of return. Now, there are lots of people who are move on the BDS position. They will move from opposition to it, to sympathy with it, to support for it. But some of those people will never go so far as to accept the right of return, because they know that does mean the end of Israel as a confessional state. Chomsky is one of them. Noam Chomsky is one such, with whom I debated on the question before. Once an opposer of the BDS movement, now its careful supporter, except on the question of the right of return, because he says it's unrealistic, because it would mean the end of the Jewish state. Well, Noam, I have one thing to say to you.
In 1968, one of the things that moved me to become a revolutionary was to realize the realism of an impossible slogan. And the impossible slogan was, demand the impossible. Because when you demand the impossible, you change the conditions under which the issue is addressed and understood. We should demand the impossible. Central to this campaign is the right of return.